Hi, everyone, and welcome to the Shop Stool podcast, a podcast for woodworkers and the maker community in general. This is episode number 27. My name is Robin Lewis from robinlewismakes.com. I'm joined by Joey Chalk from King Post Timberworks.
Hello.
And John Crawford from Periodic Furniture Studio.
Hello.
We live stream the recording on YouTube every Thursday evening at 7 p.m. Australian Eastern Standard Time, or UTC plus 10, or you can watch or listen to it later on YouTube, iTunes, or SoundCloud. I want to say hello to everyone in the chat. We'll get to your comments and questions towards the end of the show, but feel free to chat amongst yourselves, the idea being that this is also a place for people to meet. So no announcements this week. Well, none that I've got. So let's get straight into what we've been doing. Joey?
Okay, so last Friday, day after our last podcast, I started work on this little white wall-hung TV unit. It's kind of a little bit interesting. So I've filmed this one. I've just finished it today, installing that tomorrow. So that's exactly 1 week for the job, in and out. So that was pretty good. Most of that time actually was just waiting for paint to dry.
And the customer was happy?
Yeah, they've actually paid me in full up front because I've done some work for them before. So they just said, here's your money, just make a thing. The door's unlocked. We're not going to be home. Just install it and
nice.
That'll be that.
So yeah, that's awesome. Always,
that's pretty cool. So that'll be my tomorrow morning job. Early this week, Monday, Tuesday, I had, so quite a while ago, I built these really large barn doors out of rosewood and cedar. Mm-hmm. And that was for this guy's kind of little barn he built on his property. And now he's building the main house. And so he wanted a front door to match. So he came in again and milled up. We built exactly the same thing, rosewood frame with cedar kind of panels. And so he helped me build that door. Interestingly, because he just wanted to do it as a charge up. So I was actually having to keep track of my hours for that. And we built the door in 8.5 hours over 2 days. So I thought that's pretty pretty good effort, actually.
It's good going.
Yeah, it worked out mint. I was really happy with how it worked out. So that was pretty cool. Little interesting job I started this afternoon and almost finished it. It was just a capital J. It's an award for, it's an award for local magazine, Junction Magazine, which they happened to feature me a couple of weeks ago.
I wondered if that was the connection. Yeah.
Yeah. So they do an annual awards thing. I'm not entirely sure how that works or what their award is for. But they get a local maker to make the award each year. So I think last year it was a stonemason and he carved the J out of a block of some stone. I have done a brass base and then a veneered walnut J to go on top of that. So if I get some time tomorrow, I'll finish that off.
So the J, is that gonna slide over the brass pin, or is it gonna sit above it?
Yeah, that'll slide over the brass pin.
See the brass pin?
Yeah, you'll see it. So I spent the afternoon working out how to tap and tap and die some brass together. So that was fun. And that was about my week.
Cool.
John?
My week has been a bit on and off, but I guess the biggest thing I've started this week is another commission, which is this time not a dining table, which is kind of exciting. I always struggle to explain it. So it's a room divider bookshelf, but it's made to look like an old set of pigeonholes. So it's got way more like dividers than you'd usually put in a bookshelf. And it's
how many are we talking?
So it's 2.5 meters long, and that has 7 bays in it, or 6 bays in it, I should say. It's just a lot of uprights basically in there, and then dividers throughout, and it's made in two halves. So there's the bottom half, which is a bit wider than the top half, and it's like stepped. So the bottom is obviously the biggest hole, and then it steps to a smaller hole, and
So is this double sided then?
No, so it's just single side.
So what do they see on the other side?
Well, the back is going to be ship. What was it called? Ship lap. Tongue and groove, basically, and it's just solid. And then on the other side of that is kind of, it's essentially like a giant living room, and they're just wanting to divide it. So TVs on that side, right. And then, you know, the more the nook of reading and all that's on the other side.
So did you say what it's made out of?
No. So basically, this is like, it's not the heart, the brain part section of the build, because it's my own decision, but basically I'm making it out of all the stock I had on my shelf of blue gum, because it's quite it was 23 mil thick boards and only 100 mil wide, so there's not much I could do with that material, and I'm trying to make some space. So I've essentially quoted them the price it would have been if I was to make this out of plywood, so, you know, none of the lamination of 100,000 boards and gluing it all together. But basically it's a way of me making some room on my shelf. It's a job on, and it's just a lot of initial work to get the ball rolling. So it's been 3 days. Like, the first day was entirely milling, second day was entirely gluing up panels, because I'd glue up like 16 panels and then run out of clamps. So I'd have to wait a few hours and then unclamp and then do the next batch, and then today, so
gonna run everything through a sander and then get it to like a workable piece, like a piece of plywood.
Yeah, essentially. So today, that's kind of where I got through today. So everything went through the sander again, and it's all uniform. And now I can start doing layout and, you know, the easier stuff. And, you know, the budget for it isn't huge, so I'm not doing anything too fancy with joinery, but it is going to be done nicely. I was considering doing like just dovetailed casework, but then we changed from solid sides to frame and panel, and that isn't really any way I can see of incorporating that. So now it will just be standard kind of dados and grooves. But yeah, other than that, the saga of last week, the you know, the chopping board that I was going on about with 100,000 emails. Well, he's so kindly, I hate it when people say this in emails, so kindly, we've decided to go ahead with you. You know,
Guys, monkey.
But quick query, and I said, "Oh, that's great. I'll send through the official, you know, the deposit invoice, so you can get 50% up front before we start building." Then nothing for a few days, and then yesterday I got another email saying, "Quick query, if we don't glue it down to the bench top, is that going to be an issue?" And it's like, in my very first email, I advised against gluing it down. No, it's not going to, I didn't say this, obviously, but what was going on in my head is, no, it's not going to be an issue. Just freaking pay me and I'll make this bloody thing, or leave me alone. So, I mean, he's still no deposit for a freaking chopping board. Like,
yeah.
Ridiculous. But
with jobs like that, I'll say, please refer to my email dated whatever.
And
sometimes it brings it to their attention that, oh yeah, we've been emailing for like a month, and I probably should actually read this stuff.
I'm not doing any more emails to this guy. If there's any other questions, I'll ring him straight away, because it's just getting to the stage of I've gone way over what I've quoted you in just email correspondence time. So if you're not going to go ahead, just be up front. Don't waste any more of my time, because it's getting to that stage of it's not worth it.
Now, you said mentioned dado before, so I think you said you're going to groove and dado this thing together. Have you got a dado blade, or what are you going to do?
Yeah, I've got a dado stack in the panel floor.
In the panel saw, I've just got one set up, got it working Monday. I bought my dado stack 4 months ago, just about.
Right.
And it didn't have holes in it to go over the pins on the panel saw arbor.
Right.
Because it's got a electric brake, and it, you know, it's designed to, you know, to not undo the whatever. So the guy I bought it from, this company, said, this dado stack's going to fit right on. And then, of course, it wasn't drilled, and so they took it back and drilled it. They drilled the wrong size hole in the wrong place.
Oh, great.
And then I just heard nothing. It was just radio silence for ages. And then I get an email saying, look, I'm really sorry. I just don't know what to do. We can't fix this. Right. Like, okay, send it back. Thanks. So I got it back like the next day with the block of chocolate. So that was nice. and then we just drilled it out ourselves. We drilled it ourselves in a day. We had to buy a carbide tip to drill bit, but we just drilled the holes for the pins. And what? I tell you what, that thing is so genius.
Yeah.
I used it to make the tenons for that door. I was talking about, like, I made 6 tenons in like 3 minutes.
Oh, it's beautiful.
Is it that much of a game changer?
It's just rebates. It's really nice. I don't know if you're. Go ahead.
I was going to say, especially with the sliding panel saw, to make you have the stop set up and you can just repeat all the rail tenons are exactly identical and dead square and shoulders are perfect. The door went together so easily.
To do your stop block, your stops and all that, you can slide your fence out behind. It must have been last month or the month before, those two matched tables I did with the breadboard ends. I got a lot of people, giving me crap because why didn't you just use your track saw to cut it down? And the reason was I wanted to cut my tenons using my panel saw, so I had to make sure that I could get it to work. But like I removed all of that out of that video, but it probably made what would have been a half day job with a router and, you know, fence and setting it all up into a 45 minutes, and it was all done. So it's just really quick. That, and I also spent $500 on a dado stack for a panel saw, and I had to use it. So
I was going to say how much
legally you have to in that case. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think it was like $380, and then I also got some additional blades and stuff with it.
Yeah. So. Mine was about, I think I paid $480, and the Felder one is like $1,800.
Yes.
So I was like, where's the next cheapest one? But actually, it was all the trouble I had. I just about bought it because I was like, oh, should I just get something that's made for this saw or just re-drill it? But anyway, it was way cheaper to re-drill the one I had.
Jeez, $1,800. Sure.
Yeah. They go expensive.
George, going back to the blue gum you were talking about earlier.
Yeah.
Is blue gum, like if I go to a lumberyard and say I want some blue gum, is that a specific type of wood? I always thought blue gum was a very broad term for a lot of
woods. It's very broad. Like every state has, except for Australia, Western Australia, has its own version of blue gum. The blue gum I have is a Tasmanian myrtle, I think, which is a blue gum. And I got it from the Forestry Commission because they did an experimental batch where they grew a whole heap of blue gum, cut it down, and then sawed it, and then dried it. And basically just seeing the results, and they came to the conclusion that it's not sustainable enough for WA to have its own blue gum reserves. So
that's interesting.
I got like a cube and a bit, I think it was 1.25 cubic meters of it from them. But every single board has Sharpie on it where it's going over, here's one defect, not how deep it goes, here's some splitting from drying. So it's just everything is drawn on. Which is, it's not an issue. It's just, you know, I send it through the sander anyway. Who cares? But yeah, you can definitely tell it's a research batch.
It's funny, that story. The guy down the road, the studio doubled where I made that tea box.
Right.
He's recently been, because obviously he's quite an expert in his field. He's recently been contacted by one of the local forestry bodies. Like decades ago, they planted an African mahogany plantation out in the Northern Territory somewhere. And it's now getting to the point where it's ready to be, do you harvest trees?
Harvested.
And they've come to him and said, right, we're about to get all of this African mahogany. What do we do with it? You know, we haven't been continuing the growth because it was a one-off plantation. Can you come and consult for us and give us some ideas on what we can do with it? And it's just such a weird thing. Like I would never have thought that you would almost get stuck with a plantation of wood like that.
Yeah. Well, and it's a big problem. Like over here in WA, we used to have a lot of polonia, which is like an ultra lightweight hardwood, which is used mostly in boat building, but also in things like louvers and that sort of stuff. And it was everywhere. And all of these growers, because it's a fast plantation, it kind of people got over it. And then they're stuck with tons and tons of this stuff. Mm. And they ended up just bulldozing it and burning most of the crops over here. There is still a few small ones, but you know, you get stuck with it. And what do? You burn it or you mill it.
The Australian climate seems perfect to do to mill grow sapelli, you know, what Robin was talking about. You'd think that would be a good market.
You'd think. I haven't seen it anywhere, but you would think.
Mm. Because I said to this guy, this owner, like, isn't that something that you can sell, but he, you know, like from a woodworking perspective, you know, you could, but he said the problem is it's so much. It's just an like unmanageable quantity of wood, and that's where the problem comes in.
Yeah,
and I guess that's why they end up just burning it, because it's the only way to get rid of it.
Yeah, crazy. Which is kind of awful, sad, but it is the easiest way to deal with it.
Mm. Oh my God. So just looking at everyone in the comments talking about blue gum, Dirk saying it's from Sumo's project, blue gum is reddish in color.
Not the ones I got, but
every gum in my opinion is red, but that stuff that you had was particularly white.
Yeah, it's quite pale with like it's actually got blue streaks throughout it, which is really nice. So yeah, it's interesting. It's gonna look really nice when it's all said and done. But yeah, and that's cool. our wood talk. So that's our wood talk. On to you, Robin.
So after we spoke last week, I got onto. I think I was tiling last week. Anyway, a lot has happened since the last podcast. I have finished the tiling of the walls. All the silicon's been done. The shower is now operational. I had the plumber come in today and put the taps on. We weren't going to spend money on the tapware because we thought we'd try and reuse some old ones. But at the end, we just said, you know what? Let's just spend it. Get the ornate ones that we wanted. Do you know those ones that they horizontal and then you turn them like that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And they look so cool. They are so cool. So they're sort of horizontal bars that you turn inwards.
Yeah. It's like a quarter turn and it's full on, right?
Yeah, quarter turn. Yeah. And the plumber says to me, I'm going to go turn on the water. Do you mind just making, you know, just stand here. If the water's on, just turn the tap off. So I'm like, yeah, okay, cool. He goes out, turns the water on. Psh, the shower comes out. The bath comes out. And I'm trying to turn this thing and it's not going off. And it's because they don't turn in the same direction.
Right.
Yeah.
So my bathroom's bloody covered in water. Anyway.
Have you had a shower since in the last 4 weeks then?
Yes. I was just, I was going to say. So tonight, literally before the podcast, I had my first hot shower since the Easter long weekend.
Right.
And man, it was cool. So
feel civilized again?
You're like, I've been bathing, but it doesn't, you know, I'm a shower guy. I'm not a bath guy. And man, it's cool. I've got one of those big, really big shower heads, you know, those rain. And so cool. Everything in the bathroom I've done, I've painted the top half, everywhere around the shower. So basically the shower's done and dusted. It can be used. That's it, which is the big step forward. Then now I've got started on the toilet. So finished done some more tiling on the floor, built up a little stud wall behind the toilet because the old toilet had a separate bowl and cistern with a sort of arm that joined it, whereas the new one is one of these suites where it backs against the wall. So I've had to pull the wall forward, going to make a nice little nib wall with tiling behind it.
Is that in the same room or is it, have you got a separate toilet room?
It's separate. It's next to the bathroom, but it's the shower, but yeah. So I've built that little stud wall that's going to come out, framed out for the new window. So I've got to get the window ordered. But I'm hoping at this stage to have the toilet swapped out over, well, it'll be swapped out on Monday. So I've got to pull it out over the weekend. And then it's back to functioning bathroom. So I've got the, you know, the shower and the toilet and everything's back to functional. Then it's, you know, hanging doors and that type of thing. But if all goes to plan this weekend, I could finally get back to a properly, fully functioning bathroom shower. Which would be so good. This yesterday I made a small, it's like a little wooden, I guess you'd call it like a tray for the baby changer to sit in.
Right.
And it was just a simple thing made out of some pine and plywood. But it was so cool just to be down here again, just with some wood glue, some clamps, and just making a thing again, because I just haven't done any woodworking in about 2 months. So yeah, can't wait for this bathroom to be done.
Then you can like revive yourself for 6 months and attack the kitchen.
Well, one of my latest vlogs, I talked about this. I don't know if I'm going to do my kitchen. I feel so burnt out after this.
Yeah.
And I just don't know if I want to touch it. Like just I'm going to pay someone to do it because it's worth that money.
I know what you feel like. Yeah.
I think it was Leroy in the comments was saying though, the problem is you can save a bucket load if you do the kitchen yourself. It's one, he was saying it was one of those super, they put a big markup on that type of work. And
you can always do like a, the IKEA base units and then do the finishing touches yourself. So you do your own countertops and then that sort of stuff. And that's a good way of doing it where you're not having to do everything.
But the difference carry on, Rob.
I was just going to say, I'm not even doing the cabinets. All I'm going to be doing in the kitchen is redoing the floor, replacing the doors on the cabinets because the carcasses are fine.
Right.
And then bench tops.
Sure.
Well, that's not too much. I was going to say the good thing with kitchens, I mean, bathroom is definitely the hardest room to do. With the kitchen, you can build everything yourself that you need. Say if you were going to do all the cabinets, I mean, you can take measurements right from upstairs, go down, build, have everything ready to go, assembled in your workshop. Mm. And then in a weekend, smash out what was there and put the new stuff in. It's pretty quick to just do change over cabinets if you're not stuffing around with too much plumbing. But I definitely, kitchens are way easier than bathrooms.
Yeah, you're not waiting for waterproofing to go off, tile adhesive to go off. Everything's a waiting game with the bathroom. So who knows? I might still do it, but at this stage, don't even talk to me about renovating. I'm so done. So done. So we'll talk about that in a couple months.
Yeah. Until then, don't think about it.
Yeah. I wanna use some wood glue for a change and build a thing. I've already got a job from my in-laws. It's old bed heads that they want to turn into a coffee table. It's old, it's old oak. So that's going to be the next job. They want to do a split level coffee table. I don't know if you guys have ever heard of this.
I've got a split level coffee table, but I don't know if it's the same thing. It's just, it's got two bits and one slightly higher than the other bit.
I'd never heard of this idea my brother-in-law said to me, yeah, I want to do a split coffee table. And I said, you're going to need to pull out your phone and show me a picture because I have no idea what you're talking about. And it's just such a, I don't get it. I don't see why you would want that. I don't understand the functionality of it.
Yeah, I was just trying to work out.
I wonder if it's the same thing.
It's literally a coffee table.
Yeah.
And then there's a smaller coffee table above it. And then you've got some... Each one's got the common one is each panel's got the two, you know, two ends, so the two legs on either side, and there's little feet joining the two together.
Okay, yeah, no, that's not what I made.
Why? So you've got like a shelf
to make your
lose crap under it
to make your coffee table nice and asymmetrical, so it doesn't work in the center of a room. I don't get it.
Yeah, I don't know. It's not my thing. I wouldn't have it in my house, but whatever.
whatever floats your boat.
Yeah.
Well, it was pretty cool.
If you're going to get some money for it, then go for it.
So it was pretty cool to like research it you know, and figure out it's something completely new, go into SketchUp, draw it up, send them the plan that I want to do. They said, okay. Yeah. It's nice because it's family, because it's relaxed.
Yeah.
But it was nice to go through the process of what it, this is what you would be doing with customers.
Yeah, I love that. I love that. First, get a drawing out, get that initial idea onto some paper or on the screen, and then kind of sit back and think, now, can I actually make it? And how will I do that?
Yeah.
It's very satisfying.
The problem with it, we'll just go off topic for a little bit here. The problem with it is you've got the two halves, so you technically shouldn't have a rail. Your rail doesn't run from leg to leg. So you have this pivot point in the middle that's very weak. And I'm still to figure out how to get around that. In my drawing, I've just run the rail through all the way from the one leg to the other. So you've got like the small top of the coffee table, a gap, and then the rail run. So it doesn't look bad. It looks quite nice, but it's not truly the split level coffee table idea that they would go.
Why don't you put the drawing or our drawing on Discord and we can discuss it.
Okay. That's a really good idea.
We can pick all the issues with it, but not give you any positive criticism.
They're good feedback.
Yeah. We'll just give you bad feedback.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Yeah.
All right. So tonight, this is a topic from Jordan, and it's about staying motivated. Jordan, do you want to just give us a rundown of
where the idea came from? The idea of keeping motivated can be kind of adapted to a lot of areas. So like for me and Joey in particular, it could be, keeping motivated when the work quietens down and, you know, just keep swinging forward, or if you're on a long drawn out project, which is just taking forever and you know, you got to get it done, but you just want to be done with it right now, which is kind of like Robin's bathroom renovation from my understanding anyway. Personally, from my standpoint, with, you know, the delay this month and just having needy clients wanting everything explained to them, it's just been like that week where I just want to get the hell out of my workshop, go on holiday and forget it for a week just so I can freshen my batteries and come back. But that obviously can't happen. So kind of what I was looking at was some ways of keeping motivated when the going is either getting tough or just getting, you know, long and drawn out. Does that even make sense?
Mm.
Yeah, it does. Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For my situation right now, it's a good one. I'm just doing a lot of repetitive tasks. And when that happens for me in the workshop here in particular, it's hard for me to just keep doing the same thing over and over again and not just go and grab a coffee and sit down behind the computer and do some emails when the task at hand is just repetitive. This week in particular, it was 2 days of gluing up panels just so I can make some panels. It just seems like a really mundane task. So essentially what I ended up doing here is I've got this paid project, which is a commission on the go. It's got no set deadline. So what I've actually found to be really helpful for me anyway, is to get to a kind of self-made checkpoint, which is half the panels are glued up. And then I actually afford myself some time to do something that I want to do. And in this case, for me, it's I'm sitting down behind my computer and I'm teaching myself a few skills with Fusion 360, which is, if you guys haven't heard of it, it's kind of like just a CAD software, which is parametric and very in-depth software. You can do a lot with it, but it's a pretty steep learning curve. And for me, I mean, that's worked out really well for project base where it's just over and over doing the same thing. And that's just mixing it up a little bit, And I mean, ordinarily I'd have more than one project on here. I'd usually have one big one and a couple of small ones. So generally I just do that, where I do the big project, reach this deadline, or move on to a small project like cutting board or whatever it is. And that's enough to keep things interesting. But that is kind of a trick that I'm using. I don't know what you guys kind of do.
Well, just interestingly, you said about having no deadline is good for you for jobs. I think it's probably good for everybody. But I find if someone, often clients will say, oh, look, no rush on this job, just do it when you can and get it to us in a couple of months or something.
Yeah.
That is the worst for me, because it's just going to get left behind, because I'll just keep putting it off because the next client wants theirs, actually does want theirs done at a certain time. And so I'm like, right, you just keep being bumped down the calendar line. So I've found in the past, I just don't get onto it. And then next thing you know, it kind of gets wiped off the whiteboard, and then it's gone, and you get a random email a month later saying, oh, you just about finished, and you're like, oh crap.
Yeah, see, I think a deadline, actually, if it's a tight deadline, is better for my workflow, because it kind of adds that little bit of extra stress to get the job out there, so you remain focused the whole time. Like, I do enjoy having a deadline a lot of the time, but it is a nice change to not have a strict deadline. I mean, I've got my own set deadlines, because if I don't have this thing out by, you know, whatever date, then the next project's going to start falling behind. So those sort of deadlines will always be in place for me. But when it is a, you know, easygoing client who's given me, you know, design freedom and time frame freedom, it's that thing where it's a bit of a positive, but it's also a bit of a negative. So it's just finding that middle ground where I can keep moving forward with it, but not drive myself insane.
It's very funny to hear you guys, well, John, you particularly talk about you struggle to keep to you know, when you've got this mundane job going on, you struggle to stay motivated. But at the end of the day, like, you're getting paid for that. So how, not to say that you should just be a mindless worker, but like, doesn't that make it worth it?
The funny thing about me and my business, and I don't think it's a good thing, and I don't know if Joey could relate to this or not, but it's not really about the fact that I'm getting paid. Like, I don't see my job as my job, you know, like, this is my life and that's what it is. Like, I build stuff, and as long as I can pay the rent, I'm happy. But yeah, I mean, the money for me is not really a huge motivator, because I know it's there. I wouldn't be doing this job if the money wasn't there, for one. So the motivator is getting something done which I like doing, and you know, having a happy client at the end of the day. Like, my client's response is more important to me than them depositing the money into my bank account in a timely fashion. I mean, that has to happen, because, like I said, you got rent and bills to pay. But
it's not, the money's not strictly the reward, is it?
It's not the reward at all. In fact, it's just the byproduct of what I'm doing.
And for me, more often than not lately, the money is far less than I should be getting. Or for whatever reason, the money is just coming in way too slow. And yeah, so while I enjoy doing the work, it's like keeping the money actually flowing is a completely different thing. It's almost unrelated.
Yeah.
Like, because going from the doing the mundane jobs to now I'm going to start learning Fusion 360 just sounds like, well, that's just wrong, because you've gone from I'm running the business to now I'm no longer making money for the business. So yeah, it
just feels, if you don't develop your skills, how are you going to further your business?
Oh yeah, no, I mean, I appreciate that, but it just, yeah, maybe it's because of where I am, but right now my biggest motivation is to make as much money as I can on this business. That is it, you know.
I mean, I don't think you'd be, if you're wanting to get rich in this industry, choose a different industry, because you're not going to get rich being a furniture maker.
I've heard that before.
Like, just get out right now, because it's not going to get you $1 million entrepreneurship. I mean, yeah, you'll make a living and hopefully it will be a comfortable one, but like, this is not an industry where we can charge an hourly rate and get paid for it. It's an industry where your product is what will drive customers to us. And I think that has to be also a big, like, if speaking of motivation, money can't be your motivation if that's the only thing that's going, because I can make easily 3 times as much as I make here per year out in the events industry if I just tour for 12 months instead of, you know, working here. I'll make way more, but it doesn't bring me any real joy anymore. I used to like it, but not anymore. And it feels like a job. Whereas when I come here and I open up early in the morning and I start cutting wood and all of that, you know, I'm enjoying what I'm doing. But motivation will fall behind because, I mean, that's what humans are. We lose motivation very easily. So, yeah, we got to find ways of dealing, I guess.
Yeah. We talked about the bathroom renovation, and that's obviously being a very long, lengthy project. What's the longest? Because John, you predominantly do tables up until recently.
Yeah, I'm still.
Joey, what's the longest project that you've had?
Commission. Probably 2 week job. Like, yes,
not too long.
It's not very long at all. And it's something that still actually I find tricky to maintain, is that, like I said earlier, I mean, I made a door in 8.5 hours over 1 and a bit days. That used to be a week's job for me when I first started, like getting a door job. You're like, right, that's me for a week. But now, one, I've got a part-time employee to pay for. So pretty much any money I made off that 8.5 hour job is pretty much paid for him for the week. And so then I've still got to smash out another job that week to kind of make my money. So I find that I'm just having to work faster and faster, which to make the money, you've got to work fast, which is perfectly doable. A lot of people say you can't work fast and have quality, but I don't believe that's true. You just need to have a good idea of what you're actually doing.
Yeah.
And have a plan, you know? I think I just lost my train of thought there.
the reason why I was asking about the length of the jobs that you take on as commissions is, I think that has a lot to do with that motivation from my perspective. When you get stuck in a job for a long time and you're not finishing it and you're not going to finish it for a long time, that must be pretty, pretty draining. That dining table that I did over the course of about a month, about halfway in, I just remember just thinking, I'm so bored. I want to do something else.
And do you get that rush, like, if, because I know the exact feeling that you're talking about there, Robin, and if I get that feeling and I don't stop and put tools down and just get a change of scenery for a minute, I'll find that I start rushing things and then the quality starts to slip.
But the problem is as soon as you stop and you say, that's it, I'm taking a break, to me, that equates to not defeat, but like you're now pushing it. And the minute you give yourself that leeway to push it that little bit, you're going to go back to work. And this time, instead of doing a 2 hour or a 4 hour stint, you're going to do a 3 hour stint. And then, oh, now I'm tired, I'm going to take a break. And then the next time you're going to do a 2 hour stint. Now I'm tired. So as soon as you let that, let's just call it laziness. As soon as you let that laziness creep in, you've given up, you've thrown in the towel.
I mean, I can understand, and I do agree with what you're saying to a degree, but at the same time, like, so, you know, last year when I did my finger injury, that was me being in a rush for a tight deadline, which was the following day. It was a last minute addition, and it was also, I have been working on this for 16 hours today, and this guy just rang me wanting another bull, it's swear word right here. You know, this is bullcrap, and I can't be bothered doing this, but I have to do it. So I get onto it, and I take this shortcut, and that results in an injury. And since doing something like that, my mindset has changed a lot of that. Nothing is so important that it is, you know, worth putting yourself at risk, or the project itself at risk. You know, so I've changed my train of thought to make sure that I am always fresh and aware, and my head is in the job since that. And I think this is maybe a little bit of that thing. And Gareth has put a good comment, which I just saw here, which is Jord is changing jobs but not stopping working. And that's an important thing to kind of keep in perspective, that yes, I'm stopping work on this project, but I'm still working. I'm working on either my business, I'm working on a different project, I'm working on, you know, building skills which will further my hopeful development in these certain areas. And that's a good point. I'm not just stopping and sitting down and having a cup of tea and watching some Netflix. I'm sitting down and I'm doing something that is related to.
Yeah, that's true.
That is actually really good point. And that I'm probably, Jordan, you're the same, is that I very rarely can stand at my workbench for 8 hours and actually work. It's like I get to the workshop, I've got emails, maybe I'll go and put glue two bits of wood together, I'll run out and I'll do something on another job, and then maybe I've got to draw something off and email it off to a client. So the actual amount of physical woodworking I do is probably these days more like 4.5 to 5 hours over the day.
Joey, you don't woodwork per se 8 hours a day?
Not anymore. I just can't, because I'd say a third of business is making sure the business is coming in.
The reason I asked that is, like, the times when I can be in the workshop and working for a full day, like after a couple of hours, I'm tired. Like my brain's sore from thinking so much, you know, so much is going on. So that's why I ask is that the same thing with you?
And it's definitely taught me to be super efficient, because I know that I don't have super long time just to sit and think about what I'm doing. So I'm always got a problem kind of swirling around in the back of my head. So I know next time I walk into the workshop, I know exactly what piece of wood I'm going to grab and do this to it. And then I'm at the step. And that's something I wanted to bring up when you were talking about the bigger jobs, Robin, is that certainly when I was in the building game, we'd show up to a blank piece of dirt, and you've got 3 months on that site and you've got to build a house. And you could quite easily, and certainly I've seen tradesmen who just are sick of life. Like they don't want to be there. Just, you know, you can tell the kind just by the way they walk. For me, it was an awesome challenge, and I still feel that way about all jobs, is that I want to get in there. This thing, even as basic as it might be, my motivation is I'm going to smash this job out and make it look awesome. And I'm going to do it under budget or in time or whatever the constraint may be. And I've thought through all these problems, and the fact that I'm thinking ahead puts me ahead of like half of the tradesmen out there anyway. So having like a plan and then saying, right, day one, this has got to happen by the end of this week, this has got to happen. And then kind of have these checkpoints where you can, you kind of get a little bit of a high from getting to a stopping point and making a target on a much larger project. And so breaking things down and having smaller victories over the course of a bigger job certainly makes you feel a lot better about yourself.
And the thing about a contrast between when you're working construction is there's always someone that you can point the finger at. Like, oh, now we can't install the countertops till the Sparky's done these points. Oh, but the Sparky can't put these in until the plumber's done this trap, and then we can't do this. Mm. You know, there's always that mentality that when you're working for yourself, I can't do this because, okay, no, I can't blame anyone for this. I'm just going to have to pull my finger out and get on with it. But there's a little point which I was going to say with, like, add on to it, and that was with regards to, you know, we're only really getting 4.5 hours of actual woodworking time in, and that is, don't forget that if you're going to be a furniture maker, you're running a business, and you need to make time to work on your business and in your business. There's a stark contrast, and that's where so many businesses, at least from my perspective, fail, and that is they spend 100% of their time working on in the business, so making the product or whatever, but they are not working on the business, you know, marketing, getting new clients. And that's where I fell down a lot, is that, you know, I'm lucky that all my clients are just walk-in or word of mouth, but I haven't done anything to actually go and look for clients other than the odd, you know, email here and there to just let people know that I'm in the area. So yeah, you know, that's the other thing, is that there's more to being a furniture maker or a woodworker than just woodworking.
From a DIY perspective, I think it's a different ball game. Like, you know, I talked about that bathroom renovation and keeping motivated. The last time I had a project this big was back in Adelaide in my old place when I redid my backyard. And I did a video about it, and halfway through the video, I did a little piece on this feeling of you have this big project and you say, right, I'm going to redo my backyard, and you just come through with a bulldozer and you just flatten it. Mm. And now you've gone from having a pretty junky rubbish backyard to no backyard. It's that horrible feeling of now I've got to do something. It's not like I can just push this. Now I have to do something. And that's where I think it really piles on that pressure, and that's where you start to lose that motivation. I know with this bathroom, the pressure of there's one bathroom, one toilet, it's got to be done. It's got to be done now, and it's got to be done right. That's really made me struggle from a motivation perspective.
Mm. Totally.
Yeah.
And moving slightly away from woodworking, but still in line with the podcast, talking about motivation. I know there's a lot of YouTubers on this podcast. I think YouTube motivation, staying motivated as a YouTuber, is pretty tricky as is.
Oh, yeah.
I saw a video literally this afternoon about how it was someone tweeted about their video is not showing up on the subscription feed. So if you're unaware, that's, you know, you subscribe to a channel and then whenever they put out a video, you see it in the subscription feed. Apparently YouTube is now starting to curate your subscription feed. And this it was like YouTube has been messing around with our subscribers, like who, you know, people we gain and lose subscribers. Yeah. You know, off this, they own the homepage, they own the training page. So the subscription list was like our last bastion of hope. And now YouTube has basically come out and said, we're adjusting this on your behalf.
Anyway. Yes, guys, appreciate that.
Yeah. I just thought if there's anyone out there who's struggling to stay motivated on YouTube, life's about to get a bit. A bit worse,
even harder. You know, it's funny that you bring up that, because I had something very similar to that I was going to say, but I didn't know that they were going to curate the subscription, so that's great news. Awesome.
So what exactly does that mean, do you know, Robin? Are they just deciding who gets to see or gets a notification?
So when I wake up in the morning, the first thing I do is I click on subscriptions. So then, you know, over the last 24 hours, everyone who's released a video, that shows up in chronological order. Now, what YouTube is saying is it's no longer, they haven't said it in an official statement, but they've replied to a tweet that sort of very heavily insinuated this. You're now no longer going to see a 24-hour, in my case, because it's been 24 hours, you're not going to see a chronological list of what's come out. They are going to say, well, you seem to like this video more.
Right.
We're going to show these at the top. Huh. We might not even show this video because you haven't watched this channel in a while.
That's not cool.
I mean,
Instagram.
I would be fine with that if they also had like traditional subscription and then curated lists. Like, that's fine. That sounds like a good idea. So if it's something like that, I'm all for it. But if they're literally removing that function of being able to see what your the creators that you subscribe to are showing up, that's kind of ridiculous.
Yeah, there's a channel called H3H3 Productions. They're quite popular. And just before this podcast, he put out a video where he mentioned this. So you'll probably find over the next 24 hours, this will be on the YouTube news cycle that this is going on.
Cool. Yeah. Well, that's great news.
So a little motivation for you guys. I'm just trying to think if there's anything else, any other nuggets of wisdom that we can impart without it being typical cliches.
If it doesn't fit together, get a bigger hammer, that sort of stuff.
That'll do.
Yeah. That's...
One thing that I will say that, you know, earlier on we were talking about how I'm never going to do another renovation. I know I'm saying that now, but I know that in 2 months I'm going to want to do another renovation. And I guess from a keeping motivated perspective, just keeping your eye on that prize the whole time, if you can do that, you'll get through it. That for me is the knowing that A, it's going to end at some stage, and B, I'm going to have done it, is what gets me through.
Mm-hmm. Also, the bigger the project, when you finish it, the better you feel, I think.
Mm.
The completion kind of satisfaction, and you kind of sit back and, oh, thank God that's finished, and I feel awesome, it looks good, and what am I doing tomorrow?
Yeah, absolutely. That's really true. Someone on Instagram, because I put a picture of the tiling work, or it might have been on that vlog video. Someone left a comment like, "Wow, you've got such a beautiful bathroom now." And I looked and I went, "Yeah, I do." You know, as much as like I'm dying on the inside because this has just been so much pressure, I have a really cool looking bathroom, and that's that end goal.
And you get to pat yourself on the back and feel good.
And stress every time someone turns on the tap that it's going to leak somewhere.
The only thing I'd be stressed about is that quarter turn for full pressure.
Yeah.
I don't know how your basin is, but when I hit the tap too hard and it sprays all over me and I leave looking like I've wet myself, it's just the most annoying thing.
Yeah, that's true. I didn't think about that. But just
put a little water regulation.
Well, it's not too bad in the shower, I suppose. You're getting wet anyway.
That's true.
And Townsville is, you know, Townsville's got pretty rough weather, and everyone knows that I'm not a big fan of it, but they have fantastic water pressure. Like jet blast out of the tap.
So you can actually, you descale yourself in the shower.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right.
Cool. All right. Well, what are we all watching? Joey, do you want to start?
Yeah, sure. I'm sure we've mentioned this before, and if I haven't, that's stupid of me. ClickSpring.
Mm.
Go subscribe.
Phenomenal.
His video series is now on the Antikythera. Is it? How do you say it?
Antikythera is what I'm saying.
Give me the link. I took about 5 minutes saying whatever, and I eventually just said whatever. I'll let Joey say it.
I forget. This crazy thing was fished up out of the ocean. He's remaking it. It's essentially the world's first analog computer, and I can't, like, the video. I don't know how many good things I can say about this video, but so the last 90% of the video is like classic, awesome ClickSpring doing his thing. But this one is quite different, and he opens the video with about two minutes of kind of dialogue about what he's going to make about the moon phases and eclipses and such. And he just put together like proper TV quality movie quality piece of footage and voiceover and overlays, and explained it so well, even though I had no idea what the maths was happening on that on the screen. He was talking like we all understood the maths. He's like, oh, you can see the X is cancelled out, but blah blah. And you're like, oh yeah, sure.
You can totally see that, yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, just crazy. And I appreciate that the videos are getting spaced apart further, because and when you see how much work goes into them. But awesome stuff.
Yeah, I can vouch for him. Like, even the other thing I love about his videos is that he's trying to make it as era accurate as possible. So he's using tooling that he makes himself that he would have used back in the day. And it's just like, that blows my mind that he's so committed to making something in an accurate manner. I mean, yeah, he uses his lathe and his mill and stuff for certain things, but he always shows the way they probably would have done it and explain that these tools were around. And it's just it's factual and entertaining and everything. It's great.
It's the best content.
Yeah. Quick side note, or question, I guess. How do you guys find the very long series like that? I looked at the video and I thought, this looks really interesting, but I just don't know if I have the resources to go back and start
all of this. Personally, I'm super, super interested in this particular project, and so I'll watch every second of it. And halfway through his clock video is when I found him. His clock series, I got found him halfway through that, and just loved the content and what he did. I'm absolutely not a metal worker, but I appreciate what he's doing. So I could definitely watch what he produces all day. So
yeah, there's just something about watching someone with high tolerance work putting out high quality. But I personally quite like the longer format. I mean other YouTubers I wouldn't say this about, but for Clickspring, I love that long format. It multi-part, even though it takes so long between videos that it's like, oh crap, what did you do in the last one? I'll just go back and re-watch the whole series up until this point for the sixth time, and you're still entertained. It's so good. Like I often will go back and watch his videos for the fifth or sixth time. So yeah, I like him.
Cool.
Is that me? Okay, I have a fairly new channel to me, which was submitted to me via my neighbor, and that is Jeffrey Croker. He is a fellow Kiwi. So, you know, representing our little hemisphere here, and he's all about machinery restoration, which is something that I'm really into. I started on him with a drill press restoration, this old English heavy metal drill press, and he's not just restoring machinery, but he is taking it to the next level. Like, he's re-machining parts on the machines that he's fixing, or he's doing sand castings of a drill press table because it had too many holes in it, and he tried to braze it with cast rod. and ended up getting cracks, so he just recast the whole thing, and then he took it to a sand casting. And it's just like, the level of detail that he puts into it is incredible. But what's more amazing to me as a actual video creator is how concise his videos are. Like, he keeps it to a 10-minute video length generally, or maybe 15-minute, but the amount of information that he puts into it is huge. And he's also got that classic Kiwi like humor that I can't get enough of. Some people don't get it, but to me, I can't get enough of it. So if it's cool what you're into, check it out.
My pick is also another local Aussie. His name's Vic. He's down under Woodworkers.
Oh yeah, he's cool.
He's got a lot of cool videos. This one in particular that he put out this week, he made a jig for drilling dowels. He was making a plant stand, and it was just a really interesting jig. And it really got me thinking, like, you could really mass produce this jig to work with sort of standard size dowels. But what he did is he was able to drill or notch out of a round dowel so that you have that dowel wrapping around perpendicular another dowel. And I've always wondered how you could do that. And he made this really simple jig and it just worked so well in product. And then using dowels, he could join the two dowels together. Yeah, super cool, super interesting. I actually had, this week I had so many videos that I wanted to put on this list.
Yeah, me too. I had to narrow it down.
So many good ones this week, but yeah, Vic got my vote because yeah, it was a very cool video and obviously he's local, so.
Yeah, I might break with tradition and just give a quick shout out to White Dog Garage. He's got a new YouTube channel. He's a regular listener of this channel too and a long time follower of my channel. So I do want to give him a shout out because he's just done a like a little machining video on his channel, but he does machining and woodworking of some bearing race cedars. And it was an awesome video as far as info to like entertainment was just balanced really nice. So I'll give a quick shout out to him too.
Okay. So all of the three videos that we've just mentioned will be down below. White Dog Garage is not there, but was Jordan's White Dog Garage?
Yeah, White Dog Garage. Bob, all right. Over there.
We've said it about five times now, so I'm sure you guys will pick it up. We'll pick it up. Cool. All right. That's about it. Joey, Jordan, anything else you want to add to the show before we wrap it up?
Oh, no, not for me.
No, go make something.
Cool. All right, everyone. Well, thanks very much for tuning in. Thanks to everyone in the chat again. We had a nice busy one tonight, which was great. And we'll see you all again same time next Thursday.
See ya. Yeah.